The search for a second suspect in the Boston Marathon bombing is over tonight. That caps an extraordinary day in a lockdown major American city. One brother killed in a shootout with police early this morning, and a new final turn tonight. Moments after authorities lifted the lockdown of the Boston metropolitan area this evening, there were reports of a barrage of shots fired in Watertown, a suburb just to the west of the city. Then SWAT teams in black vans and emergency vehicles sped past television cameras in large numbers as bystanders cheered, "Go get him." State police said the 19-year-old suspect, Dzhokhar Tsarnaev, had fled on foot this morning and was still at large. There were evacuations of buildings near where he was believed to be cornered in a boat stored in a backyard. Federal, state, and local authorities lined the nearby streets, watching and waiting for an outcome.
For more from Boston about the latest, we turn to two of our public media colleagues joining us by telephone from Watertown. First, Phillip Martin of WGBH-TV. Phillip, welcome to the broadcast. What did you see this evening as it entered the final chapter in the capture of Dzhokhar Tsarnaev?
Well, Rick, this has been an extraordinary culmination of the day. For a long time today, for several minutes, four, five, six, seven, eight vehicles passed by this area. I'm on Nickel Street in Watertown, in East Watertown, and they sped about four blocks from here to Franklin Street. At Franklin Street, they made a left, and there they joined other police forces surrounding a home there where the individual they were looking for, they felt, was hiding. He was indeed hiding underneath a tarp. There was an effort, I was told, by two police officers anonymously that they wanted to capture him alive. As a result, they fired tracer bullets into the air. I don't know if there was a gunfight, as was reported, but I do understand that the suspect incurred injuries. So some type of altercation, perhaps some type of gunfight, ensued.
Do you know if there was an attempt to bring hostage negotiators to the scene to try to talk Tsarnaev out of this position he was in?
I don't know the answer to that question. Again, talking to police officers here anonymously, they were under orders not to talk to the media. However, I know some of these individuals. I know some of these cops, and they said they just wanted to be over with. And that they indicated that the police officers on the scene were making progress. Those are their words, that they were making progress and that they expected this to be over with soon. Sure enough, within a half an hour after I was told that, this situation seems to have ended. It seems to have ended with the capture of the suspect.
Have they taken him to a nearby hospital?
They are taking him to a hospital. I'm trying at this moment to determine which hospital. He was carried away in a vehicle where the windows are covered, a black vehicle. That's all I was told. It was a black vehicle. It could have been one of several that passed by just moments ago, speeding toward a destination that I'm not sure of. I'm trying to determine the name of the hospital where the suspect was taken.
Did the perimeter around this home shrink during the evening? It was said that police were zeroing in on a location where they suspected their man was hiding. And at the same time, Boston was allowed to get back onto the roads and people were allowed to leave their homes again. Are those two things were related? Had police finally figured out where this guy was?
You asked the right question. I spoke to a number of residents who seemed absolutely confused and bemused by it. I spoke to an individual named Bob Castro, and he had left his home after the order was lifted. He left his home trying to find someplace to buy groceries. Of course, nothing is open. When he returned, yellow tape was everywhere because of this latest development. He had returned coming back to his home. After being told he could leave, he came back and was told he could not enter. So he and several people were behind a yellow perimeter where after this latest situation developed. Now, the The police, of course, had no idea what was happening, but they suddenly, you know, they found that he was hiding underneath a tarp, and they rushed to that area. Interestingly, it's the same area where I was last night at 2 in the morning, the exact same area.
So the gunfight, the chase, and then the cornering of Dzhokhar Tsarnaev all took place within a fairly confined area. You're not very far right now from where the shootout began this morning.
Well, that's right, and it suggests that he never really got that far. Though police searched this area, it's clear that he was here all along. They searched a 20-block radius area and expanded that to a 4-mile radius area, and it's clear that he was in this area all along.
Phillip Martin of WGBH in Boston, thanks a lot.
And thank you.
We're joined now by Farah Stockman of the Boston Globe. Farah, did it take a couple of minutes to realize that it was finally over?
This has been a real emotional roller coaster. This has been quite a week in Boston. I don't think the city has seen a week quite like this.
You were in the area where the Tsarnaev family lives today. This is an area that had been under scrutiny when people began to realize that these were the two main suspects in the Marathon bombing. Were people on the block in the area where you live just sort of stunned by the whole thing?
Yeah, it was totally bewildering. There was a huge crowd of people because they were evacuating the whole block. So people woke up to knocks on the door from cops telling them to leave. For some weird reason, I smelled smoke there. I don't know why to this moment, why it smelled like smoke. But yeah, it was a really confusing day. And for the people that knew him, for the people who, the neighbors and the friends who'd gone to school with him, gone to high school with a younger suspect, it was just a shock. And everybody was gathered there waiting to see what would happen until the cops came with a big city bus and took all the neighbors away.
Did people have a hard time squaring the media accounts they were hearing of someone who was a suspect in this notorious crime with the pretty assimilated young guy that they had gotten to know as he grew up in that area?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, if you've heard the glowing statements about the younger brother all day by teachers and people who wrestled with him. I think in the last year since he's been in college, he might have become more of a partier. He seemed to sort of hang out with a crowd that might be smoking marijuana. He would tweet a lot of rap lyrics. He tweeted a lot about going to parties. But this was a kid who absolutely did not strike people as the kind of person who would do this. His older brother, on the other hand, seems to have been a bit more maybe a bit more radicalized, more openly. And my hunch is that we'll find out that the older brother kind of pulled his little brother in.
Farah Stockman of the Boston Globe, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
We're joined now by Bruce Gellerman of WBUR Radio, who's on the phone with us from Watertown. And you've been covering this story as it developed all day. What did you see as the police cordon began to tighten around Dzhokhar Tsarnaev?
Well, I was there at about 1:30 this morning. I live in Watertown, so police started blocking off streets, but there weren't a lot of police, and they kept on moving back and forth, trying to cover one street and then the other. I got down to actually within a few houses of where the shooting had taken place. There was a helicopter overhead, and there's a bit of confusion. The police didn't seem to know, you know, what was going on. They told me to get out of the area. They told me that, you know, they were afraid. They told me actually to shut off my phone. They were afraid it was going to ignite an IED. They said that there were IEDs in the area. From that, it progressed to the, you know, to the lockdown of the whole city and then Boston. And then they set up a press area in one of the shopping malls here. And then they started bringing in massive amounts of police, law enforcement, and SWAT teams and fire. Must have been 1,000, maybe 1,500 people there, and then about 200, 300 reporters gathered, a lot of trucks. with satellites, uplinks. And then it started just getting into a kind of a dull, you know, drone. We kept on getting delays in press conferences, and then you couldn't ask questions. They would just read statements. They had the governor there. They had the mayor there. They had the head of the police department, the PD, and the state police. But then they just told us to, you know, go away.
Well, we have just about a half a minute left. Was there a sense, as this was reaching its final moments, that a corner had been turned, that this was almost over?
Yes. With the shots, you know, soon after they lifted the lockdown order, there was a sense that all of a sudden they had these shots, and they seemed to absolutely have found him. And now they did, and the cheers went up, and it's over.
Bruce, just a short time ago, it's been confirmed that three other people were taken into custody in New Bedford, not far from where Dzhokhar Tsarnaev attends college, at a branch of the University of Massachusetts system. Do we know anything about that?
I don't, but if you put together some, you know, pieces of the puzzle, they told us that they were looking at a lot of databases. I thought that was very interesting. So it suggested that they were looking for links to him.
And the mayor of Boston, Thomas Menino, tweeted just a short time ago just a very simple message. We got him. Did you get that tweet, Bruce?
Yes. The crowd of cheers went up. There was a police car came up the street of Franklin Street to Mount Auburn. Another cheer. And police started breaking away into more informal knots. And you could feel that there was just a sense of great relief. It was over.
Bruce Gellerman, a reporter for WBUR Radio in Boston, thanks for joining us.
You're welcome, Ray.